Hello friends, this is Gyan Ranjan Biswal, and for the next couple of months we are going to interact about the subject, one of the very fundamental subjects of the area of electrical and electronics engineering is called network theory. Some of the experts are in some of other institutions or universities. It is also referred as network analysis and synthesis as well, or sometimes circuit theory. So, under the head of this particular syllabus, we are going to talk about electrical network circuit or electrical network theory. Let me start with a brief introduction about me. I pursued my Bachelor of Engineering from Pandit Ravi Shankar Shukla University, Raipur, then followed by the Master's degree from the Technical University of Chhattisgarh State, that is CSVT Bhilai, and then I joined the Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee, to pursue my PhD in the area of power system automation, along with the MHRD fellowship, Government of India. And since then, prior to that, in the middle, I was with the Government Polytechnic Dhurg, followed by Bhilai Institute of Technology, Dhurg. I served there for a couple of 6 years, more than 6 years. Then, as a part of post PhD activity, I joined the Srinathar University, HCL Noida, followed by the Thapar Institute of Engineering and Technology in Patiala, and then I got an opportunity to come back to my motherland, Odisha, and I have an opportunity to associate with the Veer Surendra Sai University of Technology, or erstwhile UCG Burla, and here at present I am associated with VSSU at the capacity of head of the department and as an associate professor of Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering. You see the brief course of my journey. As far as my research interest is concerned, I primarily focused, the entire team is primarily focused in the area of smart sensing and Internet of Things. In other words, IoT enabled smart sensors. Currently, one of the dedicated project of the Central Power Research Institute, which comes under the Ministry of Power, is also going on, which has one unique objective to design a gas density sensor under the head of Make in India policy. And other than that, some of my scholars are involved in the area of fuel cell lead sustainable energy systems and power system automation, robust control, and in such areas. So you can find me at any moment of time through the LinkedIn also. I put it that particular profile on the front cover page. As far as the syllabus of the present course is concerned, we are going to divide the entire syllabus of the network theory under the head of 5 modules. And under the restriction of online mode, we are going to restrict our discussions within 5 lecture hours as far as the each module is concerned. So the modules are as follows in front of your screen. That is the module 1, where we are going to deal with the analysis of coupling circuits and the transient responses, followed by we will jump to module 2, where we will talk about the two-port network analysis, and then module 3, we will jump to the network function and responses. Here in that case, we may possibly change the order of our discussion time to time as and when required, and in the module 4 we will jump to the network synthesis, and then finally we will end up our discussion, we will revert back to the analysis side along with the help of graph theory, and finally a brief introduction to the passive filter design. So what books I can advise you? There are numerable books, because it is one of the fundamental topic of any engineering discipline related to the concerned of electrical sciences. For an example, electrical engineering, EEE, ETC. So there are numerable books available, but I would advise you from my side to refer 2 books. One is the Introductory Circuit Analysis by Robert L. Boylestad, and the latest possible 12th edition is available. And the number 2 is Network Analysis by M. E. Van Valkenburg Pearson. Now the recent editions are available in the name of Pearson in India. Number of references books are also mentioned. If you feel comfortable, there is no restriction absolutely from my end. You can refer any particular book what you want, but I would insist you to focus on the lecture series, because that will not only help you to save your time, but also to optimize your efficiency as far as the subject is concerned. Okay, you can gain more by investing lesser amount of time. That's what I would say. That's what exactly the role of an academician is. Then followed by some other important reference slides are also here. You can refer. You can refer NPTEL site, which is led by one of the finest institutions in India, IITs, IISc Bangalore, and you can get the wonderful lecture series. And absolutely, you must know that it is an initiative began 10 years back under the head of MHRD, and this entire program series is available for you free of cost. So you can refer at any moment of time. For any further help, you can also refer the MIT open course. In the middle, time to time, if I am going to refer the supporting material of any other institutions or open access module, open course module, or any other book, I will be keep on mentioning it. Okay? But I think those couple of books will be more than sufficient for me. So as far as the course outcome is concerned, we are divided the entire course modules in the 5 outcomes. So I hope that by the end of our discussion, you should be ready. You should be able to follow these 5 course outcomes: CO1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. So that is based on relevant to your the course module or the syllabus of the structure. As far as our online discussion is concerned, as I said, that we are going to restrict our discussion, preferably on an average 5 lectures under the head of each module, and at the same time we will also conduct one quiz test to judge, so that you can judge yourself and you can also find the area of improvement. That's the whole motive of the series. So let's begin. Your first topic of the syllabus, if you see, it starts with the self and the mutual inductance, or in other words, the mutually coupled circuit or mutually coupled network. Okay? But before that, I invest almost roughly around another 5 to 10 minutes of time, next 5 to 10 minutes of time, to see that why we at all required to study this particular subject. Okay? There should be some relevance with it. As I said in the beginning, that this is one of the fundamental subject as far as the electrical sciences are concerned, okay, or any discipline which is relevant to the electrical sciences. That's what I mean. So what the purpose of network theory is, and why should I study it, right? So if you look at from career perspective, so let me be very frank, that it is such a fundamental subject, it will not only lay your perfect foundation, it will not only help you to lay the perfect foundation of your career in the area of electrical engineering or the electrical and electronics engineering or the electronics and telecommunication engineering, but it will also helpful in clarifying the number of competitive exams once you will reach the higher level of semesters or at the verge of your completion of the degree program, and you are going to attempt the different public sector exams, Indian Engineering Services, Graduate Aptitude Technical Test, GATE, and engineering entrance, and many more things. So this will not only help you to nourish your career in the area of electrical sciences, but also it will help you to qualify your next level exam in the peer head of your career, if you obviously look at your career in the continuously look at your career in the area of technical stream only. So you can say, to understand the network theory, let us keep it simple, and we will divide the concept of network theory in 4 different domains, so it will be easier for us to understand. So network theory, you will become sometimes come with the terminology called network analysis. Sometimes you will come through a word graph theory. Sometimes you will go through a terminology we call network synthesis. And sometimes people maybe talk about the design. So let us see one by one. What do you mean by network analysis? It is primarily a mathematical model which help you to analyze your electrical or electronic circuits. So when I say electrical or electronic circuits, so obviously it is the level of power which is driving them. When you talk about electrical circuits, normally we judge in terms of in the unit of maybe kilowatt. And even if you are reaching to the higher level, like in the transmission system, so you may be dealing with the megawatt. If you talk about the generation capacities of the entire country, maybe we are judging at the level of gigawatt and so on and so on. While in the area of electronics, you are miniaturizing the things, and therefore you are driving in the level of milliwatt and so on and so on. That is the generally standard terms. Fine. Okay. So what is network analysis? Well, an electrical or electronic circuit is analyzed for the given input, for the given electrical input, point to be noted, to find a desirable output or response from the circuit. So this whole purpose is going to meet through a terminology we call network analysis. Okay, I repeat my words. You have a given electrical circuit is available. That means within the circuit, let us assume that that is a white box. Kind of electrical input response is available to you to find a desirable response or desirable output. Okay? So when you are analyzing such a concept, is called network analysis. Okay? So what do you mean by graph theory then? So graph theory is also does the same purpose, but in that case, rather than referring a mathematical model, mathematics based equations, we refer to the graphical analysis. The reason is that generally, graph theory is applicable to analyze any electrical or electronic network when the number of matrix is a very, very complex. Or you can say that you are going to drive with the multiple number of inputs through the same circuit to generate the different possible desirable outputs at the different node. So in a simpler word, you have a multi-input and multi-output system. You have a white box, which is an electrical circuit. Now you are analyzing that electrical circuit with the help of the given or known electrical input signals to find or to achieve the desired output or response from that electrical circuit. So if there is a multiple input and multiple output and we are keep on writing the mathematical equations, then question comes that can't we reach to the conclusion? Yes, of course you can reach. But it may consume a lot of time, so that will experience a lot of delay. Okay, so remember that mathematical model or mathematical equations are nothing but it is the reflection of the response time of your electrical circuit. If you have a more number of mathematical equations and your computational system you're taking consuming much more time to solve these mathematical equations to reach to over the conclusion, that means that you are going to consume more time while through that particular electrical circuit in a real life scenario to generate a output. So in other words, we are going to experience more considerable amount of time delay. So to avoid that, we adopt the method that is called graph theory. Purpose is same as far as the mathematical model or graph theory is concerned. So I hope that is now clear to you. What is the mean by network analysis? So if it is a network analysis, then question comes to what is network synthesis. As the terminology is involved synthesis, that means you are supposed to design that electrical or electronic network. So here for the given electrical input and the desired electrical output, you are going to design an electrical network. So what makes the difference in the case of network analysis? The white box, that means the electrical network, is known to you. Type of input or electrical signal is known to you, and with the help of type of input you are supposed to find the output, obviously the desired one, but you do not know with the given input how the electrical circuit is going to behave. So that analysis part we can do with the help of a mathematical model or the graph theory by adopting it. Okay, so it is very obvious that if I'm going to change the type of input, obviously through the same electrical network the response will be changed, definitely, right? it is no more going to generate the same kind of response. Okay, so in the head of network analysis, two things are known: input and the electrical network. And my job is to find the electrical output, obviously the desired or expected one. But in the case of synthesis, what we are doing, if you see that here the type of input is known, desired output is known. So to achieve that desired output, our job is now to supposed to design a equivalent electrical or electronic network. That means to synthesize the electrical or electronic network. So that's why it's called network synthesis. That's the theoretical difference, or you can say that the technical difference between these two terminology, network analysis and network synthesis. Okay. So let us move ahead. Then what we will do in under the head of filter design. So as far as this syllabus is concerned, obviously the purpose of filter is what? It is an electrical or electronic network which help you which allows only to pass a selected range of frequencies or a particular band of frequencies through it and reject the rest of the all. Okay, so we will discuss about the type of filters and the class of filter design at the later stage. But remember, at this stage we are going to restrict our syllabus under the head of passive electric filter design only using the RL or RC components. Okay? So we are going to restrict ourselves to the linear filter design using passive elements. So that's the whole purpose of the network theory is. You are going to use mathematical model and analyze the electrical or electronic network so that you can judge the circuit, you can judge the validity or efficacy of it. It will not only help you to improve the effectiveness of the circuit in a real life scenario. Otherwise, the poor selection of a type of electrical network or the elements or the magnitude of element may lead to improper finding. Okay, or even in worst case, the uncontrolled response, ultimately which will desiredly finally propagate to the damaging of the electrical network. So therefore, the mathematical modeling or the mathematical analysis of the electrical network to be designed or is designed is very, very critical. So in the next couple of lectures, we are going to talk about this. Before that, let us rebrush some of the important concepts. So ultimately, the foundation of this subject is also belong to the basic electrical engineering, okay, or the basic electronics engineering as far as the electrical and electronics students are concerned. So the whole electrical engineering you can conceptualize in five fingers, okay, that is the five terminologies, what we call voltage, current, resistance, inductance and capacitance. So with the help of three elements and two type of sources, voltage, current, resistor, inductor and capacitor, you can conclude the whole theory of electrical engineering. Okay. So I don't think that I required to discuss about these terminologies, as you have a sufficient knowledge and information is you have been passed through at the time of during your intercourse science courses and as well as the first year of the electrical engineering foundation courses. Okay. So that's the basic fundamental what you can see over this particular slide, which help you to basically establish the interrelation between these basic quantities in terms of circuit parameter. A point to be noted that most of among of us probably might not have noticed that there is no direct relation between the charge and flux. That is because of the missing of the one of the fundamental elements, what we call the memristors. And if you have a research interest in this direction, then you can Google, you can find a lot of high quality technical article through the different publishers like IEEE, Institution of Engineers, IET, okay, or some basic information is also available through your internet. You can Google, you can type and you can find it. So if you have a memristors, then you will be able to directly establish a relation between the charge and flux. Otherwise, you have to come through the voltage or the current network to find a relation between these two. Okay. So let us now jump to our topic of discussion, the self and mutual inductance. So, but before going to define the self and mutual inductance, you know that the behavior of the magnetic field, which is driven through an inductance, is quite different than that of the electric field. Electric field follow a conducting path, but magnetic field may not be. Okay. So why we are raising this particular topic at this point of time under the head of network theory? So there is a purpose behind it. So let us come to the fundamentals, and then we will do the reverse engineering and come back to our topic of discussion, that is the self and mutual inductance as far as the potential theory is concerned. Okay. So you have already come through the some network theorems, like the first basic one is the superposition theorem, followed by Thevenin's and Norton's theorem, maximum power transfer theorem, and then there are many more. Okay, so Milman's theorems, reciprocity theorems, and so and so. Okay, so why we are talking about theorems at this stage? Because when we are going to establish the interrelation between these three basic elements, the basic elements, that is, the one is the resistive element and two reactive elements, along with the driving source, that is the voltage, which creates the potential difference to drive or to pass through the current, and current, which is the actual flow of movement of electron, you can say. Okay, so in this case, if you see, these elements are typically considered as the linear elements. Now, resistance has the limitations. You know that it can vary with the temperature. So whenever we talk about resistor, then it is a technically specified the temperature range within which you are advised to use that particular resistors. Otherwise, the characteristics may lead to nonlinear zone. So it is well understood that we are supposed to use that particular resistor within that temperature profile only, and therefore we consider resistor as a linear element. Same thing we can follow with the capacitor. It is drive through the electric field, and which basically nothing but it is an element which creates the potential difference between the conducting surface. So it is a linear element. What about the inductance or an inductor? Can we say that an inductor is a linear element? Yes. In general, you can say that linear inductor, inductor is a linear element, but this may not be entirely true. Right? So to understand that, probably we have to revisit the concepts of the electromagnetics, and that is called a skin effect. And the role of this skin effect is very, very critical, and probably you will be able to study under the head of some subjects like electromagnetics, power system stability, or maybe the different electrical subjects at the later stage. But let us quickly revisit that, what do you mean by the skin effect? So basically, how the skin effect is emerging? Distribution of current through any conducting surface is uniform. In general, it is uniform, but it is true only for the DC. Now, when we say that DC current, so ideally it is a free from frequency. It is a frequency independent term. Okay, DC is not dependent on frequency, or in other words, actually it is a constant. So there is no variation in frequency. So you can say that variation rate of change in is zero. So it's a frequency independent, fine. But as the frequencies grows, so say your frequency is growing from 0 hertz to towards your 50 hertz, okay, and in the electronic network even you can attend the higher frequency of the even up to the megahertz or gigahertz also through the particular conducting surface. Now if the conducting surface is fixed and the frequency of the input signal you are keep on increasing, that the current where it is operating on, and that current, that frequency you are increasing. So if the frequency is increasing, then there will be a non-uniform distribution of the current, okay, that will propagate from the conducting surface. So what exactly happened? If you are going to pick a conductive surface, you, as you can see the right half of the section, okay, so that the middle point we are considering, and then we consider that the radius of the conductor is a small r, okay, and the portion of the radius of conductor is the capital R that we are considering. Let us say we assume it is a x rather than r, fine. So x is the smallest or thinnest portion of the r, right? So as you will move from the center of the axis towards the surface, if you see, as the frequencies keep on increasing, the voltage gradient in the surface of the conductor is very, very low, okay? Or and the in the voltage gradient axis, through the axis, is very, very high. So that means if the voltage gradient is high, that means the concentration of current is very low at the middle of the axis, and the concentration of the current is relatively high over the surface of that particular conductor, which creates the non-uniform distribution or non-uniformity in the distribution of the current. Okay, so this phenomenon, okay, that is an increase in frequency causes the non-uniform current density, is called the skin effect. Okay. Let us go to the fundamentals of the mathematics. You know that L is equal to lambda by I, where lambda is nothing but an instantaneous flux density, I is your instantaneous current, and L is the inductance. So if you are going to follow this equation with the magnetomotive force, okay, and you are going to apply the Lenz law, so you can say that the surface of your HFX as DS, HFX is the current density, okay, is equal to I of X over the circuit surface of X, as we have assumed that X is the one of the thinner part or the thinner portion of the total length R. So if you are going to substitute this value, then I can find out the value of I of X with respect to the axis. So I of X is equal to pi X square upon pi R square into of I. So therefore H of X at the point of X or the distance of X is equal to pi X square upon, how much you will get? No, sorry. It's a pi X upon R square into 1 upon 2 pi X. Okay. So if you see that what we said, that as if you look at the current gradient or the voltage gradient, it is keep on changing from the axis of the conductor to the surface of the conductor. So if I am going to establish a relation between the current density and the radius of the conductor, or in other words we call the GMR, geometrical mean radius, okay, there are two terminologies is important, geometrical mean radius and geometrical mean distance. Okay, you will study about these things at the later stage, okay, or you can Google, you can find it. Okay, let us come back to our motive. So what we're trying to say, that if you look at the relationship of H, that is the current density, with the radius of the conducting surface, that is R, you will see that it is a non-linear relationship. Okay, your H of X is proportional to 1 by R square. Further, we are moving ahead. Let us see what will be the impact over the flux density, if it is so in case of flux density. Okay, so if you look at the flux density, okay, that is B of X is equal to mu of H of X. So in that case, if I will substitute this value, and if I am going to find out the change in instantaneous value of the flux linkage, you are going to see that change in flux linkage, that is d lambda, is proportional to 1 by r raised to 4. Highly non-linear. Highly non-linear. Now, understand this thing. Why? What does it mean? Okay? Or what information we are able to extract from this particular statement, this particular mathematical statement? It says that if you look at the change in instantaneous flux linkage, or if you see the current density with respect to the radial distance of the conductor, it is nonlinear or it is highly nonlinear. Why it is happening? Because the conducting surface is solid, is other words, it is filled. And typically this conducting surface are made by some kind of ferrite cores. Some kind of conductive materials. It may be have a alloy, it may be have a copper, it may have a, the combination of steel and aluminium, depending on that what kind of application or electrical or electronic network you have. You will have a variable kind of applications right from the miniaturized electronic network to the power plant where you are generating the power at the level of megawatt or thousands of megawatt. So the size of a conducting wire in a power plant, okay, in a generating section where you are supposed to generate 500 megawatt, can be a size of around 2 feet. Okay, that can be a basically the diameter of a conductor. Okay, so it depends. So therefore, one thing should be noted that if the conducting surface, okay, the magnetic field which is passing through it is the solid core, in other words, is made by ferrite core, in that case, this statement, the current density or the change in flux linkage says that you have a highly nonlinear relationship, right? So therefore, if it has a highly nonlinear relationship, in that case, that conductive element, that inductor will be treated as a nonlinear inductor. And if it is a nonlinear inductor, and you are going to revisit the previous slides, then you can say that that inductor is a nonlinear element. And if the inductor is a nonlinear element, or any circuit which conduct having a nonlinear element, you cannot apply those network theorem like superposition theorem, Thevenin's or Norton's. So remember, in the next time when you are supposed to apply these network theorems, you are supposed to assume that if you have a any role of magnetic field, if you have any role of an inductor in that particular network, then that inductor is a linear element. Then how will you ensure that? So that kind of inductor element, that kind of inductors are normally typically made of your air gold. Okay, so you can say that there is a hollow surface within the core. Okay, so in that case, you can assume that the inductor is a linear element, and therefore you can go for that. Okay, your combination of your passive elements are the linear elements. Therefore, the circuit which is designed using these linear elements are the linear circuit, and the system which is designed, configured based on some combination of these kind of linear circuit is a linear system. Otherwise, not. There are some other way of the network classification also. It can be classified based on active or passive network. It can be a lumped or distributed network. What do you mean by lumped or distributed network? Okay, an element, a network which is designed using a combination of, again, lumped or distributed elements. Now, what is a lumped element? Which can be further distributed, okay? And what is the distributed element? Which cannot be further distributed, okay? So, for example, a transmission line or a cable through which you are passing through a signal is a distributed network or distributed element. Whereas, the if you will take a resistor, and let's say, for example, a simple example I used to give in my class. So let's say your application requires a 4 ohm resistance, and in your laboratory you have a either 2 ohm resistance or you have a 8 ohm resistance. There is no recent availability of the 4 ohm resistance. Then what you will do? So you can make some series or parallel combination, and you can achieve the equivalent resistance of the 4 ohm. Okay, so therefore your resistor will be treated as a lumped element. Yeah, linear, nonlinear, we have already been discussed. Unilateral and bilateral, which is allowing you to pass through the signal from either in one direction or in the two directions. So bilateral are normally the semiconducting devices. So therefore, if you will come back and continue to our discussion of your self-inductance, so you know that the flux linkage can be relevant with your induced voltage. E of t is equal to n of d phi by dt, where n is the number of turns. Okay, and this relationship based on your 9.3, okay, as we discussed in the previous slides, has been shows that where L is going to defined in terms of the flux and the number of the current, number of turns, and the instantaneous value of current. Okay, so in that case, or in terms of the flux linkage, where your xi is equal to n into phi. So if you see, if you are going to draw interrelations between the flux linkage and the instantaneous value of current, you will find a nonlinear relation if it is a ferrite core. But if that particular magnetic coil, if that coil of a magnetic material is made of a magnetic material, okay, then you will get a nonlinear relationship. But if it is made of air core, that means if there is a hollow surface, okay, within the core, then you can drive this particular relation as a linear relation. Okay, so now I think probably you will to understand, okay, in which circumstances you can apply the superposition theorem over the RL network, or in what circumstances not. I hope that this concept should be now clear to you. Okay, so continue to our relations. You can use these standard equations a number of times. Okay, so because your phi is equal to the MMF upon reluctance, so you can, I can say that magnetomotive force is equal to N into I upon reluctance is the R. Reluctance is has the typically same relation what the resistance has in case of the electric field, but the behavior of, remember that reluctance and the resistance is very very different as far as the magnetic path or the electric path are concerned. They are not the same, right? So the expression of L in terms of the reluctance can be defined as N square by use these instantaneous equations. Now let's assume that you have the same source, you have a single source is probably available, but now more than one magnetic field are going to participate. Okay, more than one magnetic the inductance or the coils are going to participate in the network. In that case, if both the coils are influenced by some common area of the magnetic field, then that is nothing but it is in simpler language we call it the mutual inductance, mutually amount of inductances. That means the coil 2 has a some kind of influence over the coil 1, because of which coil 1 is experiencing some additional voltage, okay, some additional inductance, and the similarly the coil 1 has a some amount of mutual impact over the coil 2. Yeah, so therefore you can proceed to the, let's say, next slide. We will have taken just an example here that you have a two current sources, you have a two pair of coils, and then there is a certain amount of mutual flux. Okay, there is a fluxes induced in the each coil, okay, including some leakage path, but there is a some mutual flux between the two node, that is A and B. Okay, coil A and coil B, I would say, where the instantaneous value of current is passing through the network is I1 and I2. So from there you can say that the value of E2, that is the output of the first network A, is equal to, can be given by of N2 d phi 1 2 by dt. That means the amount of flux induced because of the coil 2 over the coil 1. Okay, similarly for the coil 2, okay, for 1 2, in further discussions you can see that your M of 1 2 di1 by dt can be segregated. How much amount of current? That is di1 by dt in the first network, network A, and in network B has a I2 current. So rate of change in current is di1 by dt in the first network, and in the second network B it is di2 by dt. So therefore if I will reconfigure our relations in terms of the flux linkage and the amount or rate of change in current, then M12 can be defined as N2 d12 by di1. So the ratio d12 by d1 is, remember, is a constant and is equal to the amount of flux per ampere. So therefore it can be rewritten as N2, if it is a constant, then d12 by di can be reverted back, rewritten as a phi12 by i1. So therefore your the flux linkage, the xi12 upon i2. So xi12 is nothing but N2 into phi12. Okay, so amount of flux linkage of the coil 2 due to the current of the coil 1, that is i1. Similarly I can find out the value of m21, which is equal to phi n1 phi 21 by i2, or in other words phi 1 by i2. So if you see that that is a circuit, okay, where the there is an exchange of flux which is going to derive based on the equation number 9.4 previously I have been shown you, and if you are going to refurnish these equations, your m12 will be, you are getting k n1 n2 upon the reluctance, while as m21 you will also get k n1 n2 upon r. So therefore for a bilateral circuit where you are allowing the propagation of current in two different directions in a controlled manner. M12 will be equal to M21. So in a simpler terminology, for our rest of discussion, let's say if it is so for a bilateral circuit, then rather than using two different terminology, let us use it as a one, and that is M. So therefore, M square is nothing but it is equal to M12 into M21, because both are the equal. So therefore, I can write it is K square N1 upon N2 upon reluctance of whole square. Now, what is your L1 square? That is N1 square by R square, and it is L2, okay, that is your N2 square upon reluctance, that is R. Here R meant to say is the reluctance. Okay, so therefore L1 product of L1 and L2 is equal to N1 square into N2 square upon R square. So therefore, if you will substitute it, and if you are trying to find out the value of mutual coupling in terms of coefficient of coupling, so your M square is actually proportional to L1 square L2. Okay, or in other words, M is equal to root over all of L1 L2. So if you are going to replace it with the proportionality constant, that is called the coefficient of coupling. So the coefficient of coupling should be theoretically 100%. So if it is 100%, so the value of K is equal to 1, which is very widely used in the different radio circuits also. Okay, so in this case, you can say that both the coils are tightly coupled. So if the value of K is equal to 1, that is the 100% of the flux linkage between the two coils, so you can say that both the coils are coupled very tightly. Okay, if not, if there is a some path through which the leakages of the current is occur through the both the side of the coil, in that case the value of K will be definitely lesser than 1, but it will be definitely more than 1. As the value of K is leading towards 0, you can say that the coupling between the two networks is going to be loose. There will not be that much of tightened coupled. So in that case, say that still that both the couples are coupled, but it is lightly coupled. Okay, so there are two ways, loosely coupled and the tightly coupled. So that is what you can say, that the coefficient of coupling plays a critical role to find out the magnitude of the coupling. One of the basic fundamental question is given. I hope that you will be able to discuss it at the stage. So that's what the whole motive purpose is, right? And I would suggest that also you go through this example and try to solve it. And if you have any doubt, obviously the every 5-10 minutes of the next section, next lecture series or session, we will be dedicated to discuss about the doubts raised in your mind. Remember, followed by that, in the later, in the advanced part of these particular slides, or in every lecture series, in my every lecture series, you will find some supplementary questions also, additional question also, and some concepts also that will help you to develop more understanding. And if you have already developed understanding, then you try to solve those problems that will help you to clear the fundamentals of the different areas. Okay, I would suggest you to go through that. Now, what? So we do understand now self-inductance, mutual inductance, and the mutual coupling. Then what is the dot conversion then? Right? So when there are the number of electrical networks, okay, there are the number of coils are involved, two or more than two coils are involved, then how do you know that in which direction the current is going to be induced? Right? Because in the AC network, the direction of current is changed with every 180 degree cycles. Fine. So therefore, if there is a mutual inductance between the two coils which is existing in the same network, then we use a beautiful approach, a very simple approach, that is called the dot conversion, to find or to symbolize the flow of direction of current through all the coils, so all the mutually induced coils. Okay, so remember, the thumb rule is, if the current is flowing into the dot, if the current is flowing into the dot, then we consider, okay, and it is inducing a voltage in the other winding, okay, then we consider that dot end as positively induced. Okay, but if the current flow out of the dot, then we consider it as a negative. Okay, and similarly, if the current is simultaneously flowing into and out of the dot on the winding of the flux in that core, okay, which we also consider as a additive into the network. Okay, so to have a better understanding, let us take an example. As you can see in the figure number 9.5, we have a one voltage source in the primary network. R1 is the resistive element, is used to restrict the flow of current, and then L1 is the induced element, okay, in the primary side. And in the secondary side, in the network which is supposed to be influenced with the primary network, is the combination of a R2 and L2 element, okay, within which a mesh current I2 is flowing with, that we have assumed for our convention. Now, as for your assumed convention or the given convention, if you see the dots, both the dots are lying in the same half. So if you look at the I1, value of I1, okay, in that case I1 is an incoming current, it is coming into the dot. But if you look at the direction of flow of I2, I2 is going to exit the current in the B node, at the B node, okay. So for the primary side of the equation, if I am going to concentrate on the primary side, so my equations will be R1, I1, that is the total amount of drop across the R1, plus across the drop across the L1 because of the self-inductance, that is L1 di1 by dt, okay. And because these two coils are mutually induced and the amount of mutual inductance is M, then the amount of mutual inductance due to current I2, okay, due to the coil L2 over the L1 or over the I1, in other words, I would say, is minus M di2 by dt. Why minus? Because I2 is exiting the dot, okay, it is leaving the dot, where I1 is coming into the dot, fine. So I1 is positive and I2 is negative, should be equal to the total amount of source voltage, instant value of the source voltage, that is VOS. Now if I will write my second standard equation, I hope that you can appreciate it, it is R2 I2 of t plus L2 di2 by dt. Now over the secondary surface L2, over this particular magnetic field coil, the induced amount of inductance is M, that is because of the current I1. Now the direction of flow current is again opposite than that of the flow of current of I1. So that means I1 is in while the I2 is exit. So therefore the amount of mutual inductance again will be negative. So it is minus M di1 by dt, should be equal to zero in the right up side, okay, because there is no load impedance or there is no additional source at all, fine. So you are getting these two equations, you can take the Laplace mode of these equations and then you can get the matrix form of these equations, okay. We will come over the 9.22, that is a part of 2.1, okay, while we are at the very later stage of the lecture, okay. Here you can say that that equation will help you to find the equivalent equation of the model, okay. So if I refer the equivalent equation of the model, and then accordingly if you are going to develop the equivalent network of that mutually coupled circuit, figure number 9.5, okay, then you can say it can be represented as this, right. So it is L1 plus M because of I1, and that is minus of M quantity because of I2. So minus of M is common, so it is a sharing network, and then again in the secondary side it is L2 plus, right. So that's the basic fundamentals. Let us rebrush a few more things. Like, we'll take the simple to do a exercise. Okay, let us keep it very simple. Now, if there is a two mutually coupled coil over a given electrical network, over a closed surface of the electrical network, okay, in that case, what is the value of maximum amount of equivalent inductance, or what kind of impact I would say it will put over the equivalent inductance if the two mutually induced coil are connected in series or in parallel, at the same time the direction of flow of current are the same through the both the coil, or what if the direction of flow of current is opposite. So we are going to investigate all these probable possibilities one after other. So as a first case study, let us assume, as you can see in the first example over the slide, we have considered two inductance L1 and L2. We have assumed that the amount of mutual inductance is M between the two inductive surface, okay, inductive elements L1 and L2. The amount of voltage is V. Obviously, it is instantaneous value, but for the sake of the simplicity, I omitted all these values. You can consider it is a DC value. Okay, so is a DC source, or even if it is a AC source, you can write that value of V of T. Now, if it is so, in that case, you can say that for this network, as you can say that the current, because it is a single closed loop network which has a two inductive elements, so the amount of current, let's say assume is passing through it is I, so I is also going in or passing in through the dot which is married or phased over L1, and the current is also incoming for L2. So therefore, what will be the total amount of distribution? V is equal to L1 di by dt. Now, because of L2, you are getting mutual inductance. So that means you will get a positive mutual inductance. So because of this, you are getting M di by dt. Then when the same current will pass through the L2, so because of the self-inductance, you are getting L2 di by dt. And because of mutual inductance due to L1, again, the direction of flow current is same, so you are getting this type plus M di by dt, or in other words, you can say that it is L1 di by dt plus L2 di by dt plus 2M di by dt. Therefore, the equivalent value of inductance, L equivalent, is equal to sum of the individual or self inductance L1 plus L2 plus mutual inductance, that is twice of M. So the conclusion says that if the direction of flow of current is the same through both the mutually induced coil, then in that case the amount of equivalent inductance will be always more than that of the sum of the self inductance value L1 plus L2. So here the amount of magnitude of L equivalent is going to increase by the factor of twice of M. What if the dot conversion is in opposite direction? So as you can see in the second example, here you can see that the dot conversion shows that the current is passing in, is flowing in through the L1, where it is exit through the L2. So that means there is a 180 degree phase reversal while the L1 and L2 are connected. Remember, this is a circuit representation. When you will connect the L1 and L2, okay, you have change the polarity of the L2, and that's there is a phase reversal you are getting, not phase in. Okay, so therefore, now the mutual amount of inductance in this particular network will be always opposite. It is not going to favor to the adjacent magnetic field. So therefore, when you are going to write the equation for L1, that is due to self, it is L1 di1 I by dt, but because I2 is opposing, L2 is opposing, so therefore we are getting minus M di by dt. Now for L2, again the thing is same, L2 di by dt, that is due to the self-inductance, again minus M di by dt. Now this time this minus M di by dt coming due to the L1. So therefore, if you look at the total amount of equivalent inductance, it is L1 plus L2 minus or twice of M. So that means if there is an opposite flow, direction of flow of current through both the induced magnetic field are opposite, in that case the equivalent inductance will be always lesser than that the sum of the self inductance L1 plus L2. Okay, so equivalent inductance is reducing. So that's how you can find out the value of equivalent inductance, or in other words, that's how you can also control the impact of the equivalent inductance over a given network, because remember, you are analyzing the network. Okay, you are analyzing the network. Whatever we have discussed now, it is now coming under the head of network analysis. Okay, so your input is known, your circuit is known, and you are wanted to generate a desired output, or you are wanted to find an unknown output. Okay, so output is not in your hand. Okay, unless you are not going to change. Okay, unless you do not allow to change the. Let us consider the different scenario. What if the both the coils are connected in parallel as compared to the previous example? So if both are connected in parallel, again there can be two possibility ways. Okay, both the dot conversion can be in favor or the dot conversion can be in opposite direction. So if it is in favor, as you can see in this particular presentation or this particular slide, number 230, so you can see that, so V1 is equal to L1. Okay, but remember now it is a parallel network, so current is going to be divided. So let's say through the first element L1, the amount of current is passing through is I1, and through the second element, symbolically, I'm assuming the amount of current passing through is I2 to make our analysis simple and easily understandable. Okay, so we can derive two equations now, where we can say that V1 is equal to L1 di1 by dt, that is the amount of voltage drop due to the self inductance, okay, plus M di2 by dt. Why plus M? Because the current is also passing in through the dot across the L2, and current is also passing in through the dot across L1. So direction of flow of current through both the coil are same. So therefore, mutual inductance is favoring. So you are getting a positive value. If you look at the same equation for the L2, because it is a parallel network, so the amount of voltage drop is obviously same. So whether you write V or V1, it doesn't matter. So V1 is equal to L2 di2 by dt plus M di1 by dt. Now you know that both the voltage drop are same, so you can compare both the equations. You can do the permutations and combinations. Okay, your ultimate goal is to find out the value of your equivalent inductance. Okay, so in this particular presentation also, to make the little more complications, we have added the third induced coil. So you can either consider this example, or you try to solve the parallel network where the circuit is favoring or the circuit is opposing. Okay, what if it is opposing? And then in the next lecture, we will be able to discuss the solution of this network. I hope that you will be able to solve. You enjoy the today's class also. Do not hesitate to contact me through email ID. I have been provided over the cover page. At the same time, the next lecture tomorrow, when we will meeting as per the next schedule, we are going to first handle the doubt clearance session for the 5 or couple of minutes of time, and then we will continue our discussions for this particular. And there we will discuss the coupling of energy transformation and the applications of this coupling network, like the ideal transformer, the actual transformer, the source transformations. Okay, so these concepts we will discuss in the next slide. Okay. All the best, and wish you good luck. And remember that I have been already provided certain exercises at the end of the supplementary slides. You can refer those slides, and I also advise you to try to solve those problems and develop your concept. Okay. Wish you good luck. So we'll meet you.